stage in life, some of us might end up by being confronted with the dilemma of coming to terms, or rather with the urge to undo the doings of our families, the modes of socialization, the lifestyles we unconsciously swallowed or culled, and from time to time we would even hopelessly struggle with our second nature, in which we have been molded into, or what sociologists, more specifically the French sociologist Pierre Bourdieu, would define as the complexity of habitus. Above all, many of us seem to have been for long years caught in the windmill of stirring the past through wrestling with our inner worlds in search for an identity. This would look as if you would be entering a long and dark tunnel that might lead to a painful investigation, a kind of a meditation work, which can eventually be a process of liberation. While never being sure of the outcome, we only hope that this was the right path to take. Evidently, families are neither a simple matter to be untangled, nor to be exposed publicly, or to be scientifically dissected. Families are the most intimate and yet most distant and possibly most hurting constituent in one's life. Families are our prime shapers and nurturers. Families constantly play us tricks on our destinies and future actions. And we all know that we tend to hang our successes and failures on our families. Families, as Freud time and again told us, are a treacherous and risky enterprise. Yet, the book I'm presenting today is not solely narrating a family story. Neither it is about memorabilia or nostalgia, even though my pictures, my photography tends to look like. Nostalgia, as we know, lends too long into a vanished and beautiful past, because the past was beautiful for only a few and quite dreadful for many. Nor it is exclusively about Egyptian land-owning elite's fantasies of luxury. Even though the visual element is given prominence, photography as a means lends to romanticizing the subject through a systematic wish to aestheticize what we capture. Photography. After my mother's departure, photography provided me with a curious disposition. It put me in a sort of a mood, rather a trance that assisted me in my mourning. It stimulated in me a way of hunting for invisible spirits, precisely through a peculiar setting, the suitable and decrepit romantic ruin. But that is not the whole story. For the reason that long before I delved into the grieving mood, for many, many years, photography was my main means of documentation as I was training to be a sociologist. My struggle with photography portrayed a tension between the paradox of wanting to thoroughly record labor, pauses, action, movements, in contradistinction to the conscious or unconscious wish to aestheticize my landscapes and people. So, by linking the birth of photojournalism to the field of urban studies at the turn of the last century, Frederick Starr tells us that the medium of photography revolutionized numerous fields. And I quote him here, "In the hands of journalists, it created a new and powerfully accurate kind of documentary record. In the hands of social activists, it created images of passion and outrage that could not be ignored. In the hands of the popular masses, it created snapshots and memories, both social and personal. And in the hands of artists, and who with a camera in his hands was not an artist, it created art. The wish to fixate or typically freeze a moment, a posture or a situation, seems to automatically lead to antiquated situations. To put it in the words of Susan Sontag, the photographer is really engaged in the enterprise of antiquating reality, and photographs are themselves instant antiques. And yet, here lies one more contradiction in the very medium of photography. Once again, Frederick Starr argues the following, and I quote him here, "Photography is arguably the single most characteristic medium of expression and representation of the modern period." Once again, the paradox here then remains between photography as being in per se a modern medium, and yet it can hardly escape the pervasive effect of antiquating reality. Likewise, it seems that photography can equally hardly escape the nostalgic effect it produces, exemplified in the repetitive and emotional act of meditating a family photo album. But aren't we all attracted by instant antiques? Don't we all want to be unique artists, and yet are we not relying increasingly on mass-produced digital cameras equipped with an endless numerical multiplication of images? Throughout the process of writing, I was quoting even more struggles, tensions, paradoxes, and dualities. The sociologist in me was constantly wrestling with the process of exposing a personal setting that was full of contradictions, violent pasts. So how far can one expose a family history without compromising others or oneself? How far can one expose intimate psychological deprivations, recurrent cyclical common family traits? Can one create out of these repetitive traits possible archetypes that would make sense sociologically? Can one single story be contextualized into a broader historical canvas? And how to associate family feuds within the field of social psychology, a field which the late German sociologist Norbert Elias wonderfully developed, or to imagine the possibility of repetitive patterns pertaining to inheritance, marriage strategies, gender inequalities in Egypt, inequalities which evidently breed eternal resentments between sexes. Can these questions explain circular and repetitive family feuds over land and inequalities over preferences, tastes, likes and dislikes? And how can these questions be inspiring theoretically? How to attempt to bind two entirely different life worlds through just a common space like an estate? And is cotton enough of a binding thread to weave my story? Centrally during the process of writing, the concern was how to reconcile sociological imagination with the world of affect and emotions. And that is, I think, the most difficult part of the story. More paradoxes grew when I was trying to imagine how in the 30s and 40s it must have been to be working in an extremely regimented labor camp as a permanent worker, to be tied to a place, to be enslaved by mere survival. Once again, that thought was put aside side by side with the present-day ruin that lends to all sorts of romantic meditation about the past and the lavish lifestyles of the land-owning elites. What about power and the cultivation of dual personalities? Personalities that exulted in authoritarianism coupled with an extreme sense of order and control. Yet, they were able to create the most disorderly and chaotic situations once the power instinct was challenged. One and the same person who is able to exercise a great brutality towards subalterns and would yet reveal a high sensitivity towards music and poetry, for instance. Once again, how to retell differently the same old story, the old story of the oft-repeated contradictions between tradition and modernity, Europeanization, and the clashes between the generations that followed within one and same family. How to narrate it on an intimate and visual level? Here, not only photography, but account books, oral history, were essential devices in shaping my narrative. The book took many years to simmer, since these contradictions remain unresolved. There was a time when I resisted the idea of giving the work away. Neither did I really want to exhibit the photos, as I derived a great pleasure just through endlessly experimenting constellations, associations of series of photos. I have learned that it is often the process of playing, or rather of flirting with the images and the words, that is most important.